Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. I begin in the name of Allah, the All Beneficent, the All Merciful. Nuqush-e Ismat, Imam Ali Naqi Hadi, peace be upon him, part 1. Birth, 5th Rajab, 214th year after Hijrah. Martyrdom, 3rd Rajab, 254th year after Hijrah. Life sketch of Imam Ali Naqi Hadi, peace be upon him. It was 5th Rajab, 214th year after Hijrah, when another carrier of divine effulgence appeared in the house of Imam Muhammad Taqi, peace be upon him, and Providence sent the 10th successor of the Messenger of Allah to this world. Reference, Nurul Absar, page 139, Damatus Saqiba, page 130. During that time, life of Imam Muhammad Taqi, peace be upon him, was passing in great hardships. After the martyrdom of Imam Ali Reza, peace be upon him, Mamun had summoned him from Medina to Baghdad and married his daughter to him to protect his rule. In this way, the family life was also troubled in addition to external troubles that he faced. On one hand was the simplicity and piety of Imamat, and on the other hand was the royal life of the woman he had married, who had never ever seen true Islamic atmosphere. Thus his family life was full of discomfort and trouble. Imam solved this problem within a year when he left the affluent house of Mamun and decided to move from Baghdad and reside in Medina. But the same trouble accompanied him there, and Ummul Fadl, in addition of harassing the Imam, wrote continuous letters of complaint to her father and continued to instigate the ruler against Imam, till Providence persuaded the Imam to take a second wife in order to continue Imamat. He married Sumana Maghribiya. As soon as he married, there was a chaos in the house, and Ummul Fadl raised a great frasas. She complained to her father and relatives and continued to create mischief in the regime to harm the Imam. Imam paid no attention to these mischiefs and continued with his mission. He never accorded preference to the princess over the ordinary ladies of the house, as anyone who has lived through such circumstances knows this well. Providence soon gave Lady Sumana a male child, and this worsened the situation further, as if childlessness, simplicity and presence of a co-wife were not enough. Ummul Fadl also had to witness that his co-wife had become a mother. In Islamic history, rivalry of a childless woman with a lady with issues is ancient, and even great ladies could not remain safe from it, whereas Ummul Fadl didn't even have any distinction, and neither has the Muslim world derived its one-third religion from her. The consequences were obvious, but when Providence wants something, there is nothing which comes in the way, and Musa was born in spite of all care that Pharaoh had taken. Thus, Imam Ali Naqi Hadi, peace be upon him, began his life in a strange atmosphere of jealousy. Reference, Sawan Imam Muhammad Taqi, Volume 2, page 11. His mother was Sumana Maghribiya, who was definitely from non-Arab descent, and that is why Arabs were not prepared to accord her the position which belongs to the Arabs, and behaved with others like slaves and maids. However, from the aspect of character, she was superior to all the ladies of her time, and that is why the holy Imam, in spite of being from the most noble stock of Arabs, married non-Arabs to defeat Arab pride in descent and to end difference between Arabs and non-Arabs. And the importance of faith and character in Islam should also become clear. The least praise of Lady Sumana is that she used to observe fasts the whole year, and there is great excellence of this in traditional reports. In some traditions, it is mentioned that if one cannot fast for all days, one should keep 3 fasts every month, and they would be counted as 30 fasts. But it is clear that is a cure for helplessness and not a formula for cunning and laziness. So those are capable should, instead of using tricks, take recourse to deeds, and then they should take the help of sincerity for acceptance of deeds, so that the deed is accepted by Allah. Reference, Irshad-e-Mufid, page 358. It is necessary to clarify about Yawm-e-Dahar, that fast during this period, the days in which Sharia has prohibited fasting, is exempted, and in those days in which Islam has prohibited fasting, Because in Islam, the foundation of deeds is worship and not habit. If divine command is related to the deed, it is worship to perform that deed. And if command of God is to leave the act, leaving of the act is worship of the Creator and servitude to God. There is no scope of interference of any customs or personal feelings, and neither is the deed related to the praise or criticism of God. Worship is worth praise in the view of Lordship, and in that there is no importance of the view of man. Reference Jannatul Khulud. His name was Ali and his titles were Najib, Murtada, Alim, Faqih, Nasih, Amin, Mu'tamin, Tayyib, Naqi and Hadi, etc. Some traditions have also mentioned Mutawakkil as one of his titles, but he prohibited his companions from addressing him with this title, as this could be taken as an excuse by the tyrant ruler to take revenge, or his character would become doubtful to ordinary people, and they would begin to imagine every Mutawakkil to be having the same character. Reference Ilam al-Wara, page 225, Matalib al-Su'ul, page 291, Nurul Absar, page 149, Kashful Ghumma, page 122, Ihsanul Maqal, volume 2, page 239. He is also referred to as Askari because of his residence in the locality of Askar, and his illustrious son is also called by this title. On the contrary, his most famous title is Askari because he had more connection with this locality, and in this way, both Imams together are referred to as Askariyain, Arabic for two Askaris. Just as Imam Musa Kadim and Imam Muhammad Taqi Jawad are called as Kadumain and Jawadain. Reference Muntahiul Amal. He was born at Suraiya, at some distance from Medina, where Imam Muhammad Taqi, peace be upon him, used to stay often, and perhaps he had lodged Lady Sumana there in order to avoid domestic tension, and Providence bestowed him with a son. Reference Irshad-e-Mufid, page 494, Biharul Anwar. His kunyat was Abul Hasan the third, because before that Imam Musa Kazim and Imam Ali Raza were called as thus, and in some traditional reports he is also referred to as Abul Hasan Madhi. Reference Ihsanul Maqal, volume 2, page 239. When he was born, Mamun was on the throne. After that, in 218th year after Hijra, Mu'tasim Billah assumed power. In 227th year after Hijra, Wasiq succeeded to the throne. Wasiq died in 232 after Hijra, and the kingdom came under the control of Mutawakkil, and he remained in power till 247th year after Hijra. After that, his three sons ruled one after the other. Muntasir ibn Mutawakkil came to power in 247th year after Hijra, Musta'in ibn Mutawakkil in 248th year after Hijra, and Mu'taz ibn Mutawakkil in 252 years after Hijra. Mu'taz had the Imam martyred through poison in 254th year after Hijra. Reference Abul Fida, Damatus Saqiba, page 121, Tadkiratul Masumin, Ilam al-Wara, page 339. Of all these tyrants, the worst was Mutawakkil. He is also called as Yazid of Bani Abbas. Such was his faithlessness and licentiousness that he had 4,000 slave girls in his palace and all were at his disposal. He drank wine without any restraint and was such a cruel fellow that he shed the blood of not hundreds and thousands, but hundreds of thousands of believers and sadats. He asked a literateur like Ibn Sikkit, whether my sons are better or Hasan and Hussein. Ibn Sikkit said without any hesitation, leave alone Hasan and Hussein. Your sons cannot be compared to their slave Qambar. As a result of this, he had his tongue pulled out from the back of his head, although he was considered to be the most influential person in the court. It was Mutawakkil only who had begun the job of eradicating the signs of the tomb of Imam al-Hussein, in which, by the grace of God, he could not succeed. A poet has aptly said, reference Tariq-e-Khulafa, Suyuti, Ihsanul Maqal, volume 2, page 282, Abul Fida, volume 2, page 14, Tariq al-Islam, page 65. Come and see, O Mutawakkil, the tomb of Hussein. The land rose up and the water took a detour by itself. The Imam was very young in age when Mu'tasim Billah summoned his respected father from Medina to Baghdad in 219th year after Hijra. and he was separated from his father, after which they never met. Imam Muhammad Taqi Jawad reached Baghdad on 9th Muharram in 220th year after Hijra, and the tyrant had him martyred on 29th Zikad of the same year. Reference Nurul Absar, page 147. Since the Imam was unable to be trained under his father, some people became sympathetic to him, and Umar ibn Farrah appointed Ubaidullah Junaidi as his teacher. But after some days, when he asked Junaidi about the progress of the child, he said, "People think that I am his teacher. By Allah, I learn from him, and his knowledge and excellence is much more than mine. By God, he is the best of all." Reference Isbatul Wasiyya, Damatus Saqiba, page 121. Knowledge and Perfections. Thiqatul Islam Kulaini narrates that Imam Muhammad Taqi Jawad, peace be upon him, said to Naufali that Almighty Allah has 73 great names, of which one was bestowed to Asif ibn Barkhiyya, through which he brought the throne of Bilqis from Saba kingdom to Sulaiman, peace be upon him, in the blink of the eye. We are bestowed 72 names from them, so no one can have any idea about our power, and the Lord of the world has concealed a name from us also, as it is the speciality of his lordship. We should know that knowledge is supposed to make discoveries, and it is not related to power. But by referring to the throne of Bilqis, Imam Muhammad Taqi Jawad has implied that knowledge of the great names is not limited to exposition of realities. A kind of power is also found in it, through which the earth can be folded up. Thus, if one great name could have such power, what would be the condition of 72 great names, and how great would be the power which is 72 times that of Asif ibn Barkhiyya? Reference Damatus Saqiba, page 126, Manaqib, volume 5, page 118, Usul-e-Kafi. In 227th year after Hijra, when the Imam was 12 or 13 years old, he was standing at the roadside with Abu Hashim when Turk soldiers passed from there. The Imam began to talk with one of them in Turkish. He was absolutely amazed, and he fell at the Imam's feet and said, "No one other than my father is aware of the name with which you have addressed me. It means that you are a holy saint." Reference Ilamul Wara, page 243, Biharul Anwar, volume 9, chapter 3, page 131. In another report of Abu Hisham, one day the Imam began to speak Hindi, and I said, "Mawla, I don't understand this language at all." He picked up a pebble and applied saliva to it. When I placed it on my tongue, I became proficient in 70 languages. Reference Ilamul Wara, page 243, Biharul Anwar, volume 9, chapter 3, page 126, Mukhtarul Kharaij wal Jarai, page 237. It is obvious that when such is the effect of the saliva of Imamat, what would be the effect of saliva of prophethood? And when such effect is found in saliva, which is considered to be an extra moisture of the body, what would be the effect of blood, which is the real part of the body and an element of life? Only after realizing this matter can the following statements of the Prophet be explained: "The blood of Ahlul Bayt is my blood, and their flesh and skin is my flesh and skin." Shaykh At-Tusi writes in Mizbah, "Ishaq ibn Abdullah came to the Imam to issue judgment about a discussion, and as soon as the Imam saw him, he said, 'If you want your uncle to judge the discussion, you should know that there are four important fasts in the year. 17th Rabiul Awal, the day of the birth of Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him and his pure progeny. 27th Rajab, day of proclamation of prophethood of the Prophet. 25th Ziqad, day of Dawul Ard, when land was spread out for the first time. And 18th Zilhaj, when Islam became complete and blessings were perfected." Reference Manaqib, volume 5, page 123, Damatus Saqiba, page 123, Ihsanul Maqal, volume 2, page 245. Allama Jami reports that when a follower of Imam complained to him about Qazi of Baghdad, he said, "There is no need to complain about it, as he would automatically be dismissed after 2 months. And the same happened, as you can run the government with infidelity, but you cannot run it with oppression." Reference Shawahidun Nubuwa. When Mutawakkil was poisoned, he made a vow that if he survived, he would donate a huge amount to the poor. After regaining health, when he asked jurists how much that amounted to, all offered different view without any solid proof. Finally, someone took permission to ask Imam Ali al-Hadi al-Naqi, peace be upon him, about it. The Imam said, he should give 80 dirhams. Mutawakkil asked for reasoning and he said, Almighty Allah helped his messenger on many occasions, and according to history, they are 80 in all when he confronted the infidels and God helped him. Reference, Manaqib, Volume 5, page 116. The King of Rome wrote a letter to the Caliph of the time. It is mentioned in Injil that one who recites a chapter without the following letters, Tha, Jeem, Kha, Va, Sheen, Tawat, Fa, would become eligible for paradise. Please tell us which surah is that. The Caliph inquired from Muslim scholars, but they were helpless. So he asked the Imam and he said, it is easy. It is Surah Hamd, which does not have any of these letters. It is because Sa stands for Sabur, destruction. Just Jeem stands for Jaheem, hell. Kha is for Khayb and Khusran, failure. Za is for Zakkum, bitter fruit. Sheen is for Shakawat, misfortune. Dwad is for Dulamat, darkness. Fa is for Furqat, separation. Therefore, Almighty Allah did not use these letters in this blessed surah. We should know that it does not imply that any surah containing these letters is not a surah of mercy and blessings, because they are present in Surah Rahman and Surah Dahr, whose main subject is divine blessings. On the contrary, it is a special secret that Imam has mentioned, and it was known only to the King of Rome, and that is why he was satisfied. He accepted Islam and remained a Muslim all his life. Reference, Damatus Saqiba, Volume 3, page 123, Sharh Shafiya, Abu Firas. Seeing such incidents, scholars have pointed to that scientific law that incidents cannot indicate general laws. Their specialities are related to them, and in presence of specialities, general laws cannot be derived. Always, two views have existed in the Muslim world about free will and compulsion. Some people have promoted belief in compulsion so that no blame should fall on them and God should be made responsible for every act. Thus the proverb was publicized that not a leaf moved without the command of God. So how can a man move? Although two weaknesses are found in this proverb. First of all, the Holy Quran has mentioned knowledge of God and not his command. Secondly, a leaf is included in the plant kingdom, which lacks power of contemplation. Thus, a leaf cannot be compared to man who is bestowed with will, discretion and understanding. On the other hand, fans of great personalities popularize belief in free will, tafweel, that man is absolutely free in all his actions and God cannot interfere. He has delegated all discretions to man. In the period of Imam Muhammad Taqi also, when this question arose, he issued the same judgment that his ancestors had given, that in Islam, there is neither compulsion nor free will. On the contrary, the matter is between the two, Amr Bain al-Amrain. Discretions are given by God, but responsibility of deed lies on man. Neither can he become needless of divine discretions, nor God be held responsible for use of this discretion by man. Reference, Damatus Saqiba, Volume 3, page 134. In 232 years after Hijrah, when the Imam was around 20 years old, an Azbati man from Iraq came to Medina and met the Imam. He asked about his ruler, Wasiq, and he said that he was all right. Then he asked about Ibn Zayyad. He said that nowadays he was in charge of complete administration and he was living in prosperity. Imam said, your information is obsolete. Wasiq has died, Mutawakkil has come to throne, and he has eliminated Ibn Zayyad. Azbati asked in bewilderment, when did it all happen? Imam said, 6 days after you left Iraq. After some days, these facts were verified and the unseen knowledge of Imam Muhammad Taqi was confirmed. Reference, Nurul Absar, page 149, Egypt, Irshad-e-Mufid, page 209, Manaqib, volume 4, page 410. Miracles. Muhammad ibn Farid says that Imam Muhammad Taqi, peace be upon him, wrote to me that I should pack my belongings and prepare the arms. I was confused what the Imam could mean. After some days, the Egyptian police apprehended and placed me under arrest and confiscated all my property. I remained in prison for 8 years. One day I received a letter from the Holy Imam. Beware, do not go to the west. I was bewildered that I was in jail. How can I go to east or west? After some days, I was released from the prison and I wrote to the Imam to pray that my property is restored to me, and it happened thus. Reference: Irshad-e-Mufid, page 311, Al-Kafi, volume 1, page 500, Biharul Anwar, volume 9, chapter 3, page 136. Ali ibn al-Hasib says, I was walking along with the holy Imam and by chance I took over the Imam and asked him also to increase the pace. He said, you have to go ahead of me. Thus it happened that he died after some days. Reference: Kashful Ghumma. Abu Ayyub wrote to Imam al-Hari that his wife was pregnant and requested him to pray that he may get a son. Imam said, a son would be born to you, but you should name him Muhammad. He did as advised. In this way became clear the aim of Al Muhammad to keep alive the name of the Prophet. Reference: Biharul Anwar, volume 9, chapter 3, page 142. Kashful Ghumma, page 247. Yahya ibn Zakariya wrote that his wife was also expecting and that the Imam should pray similarly for him. Imam said, many girls are better than boys. Thus Imam revealed the sex of the unborn child and rejected the un-Islamic belief that boys are superior. If it had been so, Almighty would have given only sons to Holy Prophet and would have multiplied his generations through males. It was the same reply that Almighty Allah had given to the mother of Lady Maryam. Reference: Biharul Anwar, volume 9, chapter 3, page 142, Kashful Ghumma, page 247. Abu Hashim said, I mentioned my precarious economical condition and requested him for monetary assistance. Imam gave me a handful of sand and said, sell it and use the money. When he looked at the sand, it had turned to gold, and a miracle like that of Imam Ali al-Hadi was again displayed. Reference: Manaqib, volume 5, page 119. Abu Hashim says, when Imam came to Samarra, I said to him with utmost respect, I live in Baghdad. I cannot visit you every day. My beast of burden is also weak. Imam said, Almighty Allah would make your beast strong. As a result of this, I used to pray the morning prayer in Baghdad, noon prayer in Samarra, and Maghrib and Isha prayer in Baghdad. Whereas there is a distance of more than 100 miles between these two places. Reference: Ilamul Wara, Allama Tabarsi, page 208. Allama Sheikh Abbas Kummi says, the ruler wanted to show off his power to the Imam, and he had a mound prepared in the desert and ordered the whole army to assemble there. When 90,000 armed soldiers gathered, he took Imam Ali al-Hadi on the hillock and wanted to show off his power. Imam said, now look at my power. Saying this, he passed his hand over the eyes of this ruler. When he looked, he saw that as far as the eye could see, there were armies from earth to sky. He was shocked and he fell down unconscious. Imam brought him into consciousness and said, don't worry. We Ahlul Bayt never use this God-given capacity for personal use, and neither do we take any revenge from those who oppress us. Reference: Kharaj wal Jarai. Allama Abdul Rahman Jami writes that once Mutawakkil got a terrible boil, which was incurable. So his mother made a vow that if he was cured, she would donate 10,000 dinars to Ibn Riza. Fatah Ibn Khagan said, if you permit, I will ask His Eminence Ali Naqi al-Hadi. Mutawakkil was compelled to permit. He wrote a prescription, and when the courtiers heard it, they burst out laughing. The minister advised giving it a try, and within a few days it was completely cured. Courtiers were degraded and the mother sent a bag containing 10,000 dinars to the Imam. Reference: Shawahidun Nubuwa, page 207, Ilamul Wara, Allama Tabrasi, page 208. Abdul Rahman Misri was not among the followers of Ahlul Bayt, but one day he declared his devotion to Ahlul Bayt in public. People were amazed and they asked him to explain. He said, I had gone to Samarra. I heard that Mutawakkil had issued a verdict of execution of a Sayyid Alawi and that he was supposed to arrive after some time. I waited to see who that person was. I saw a man being escorted there. I was much aggrieved at his nobility that he was being executed when he was innocent. He came near and said, O Abdul Rahman, don't worry. I cannot be killed. I was amazed how he came to know my name, and I became a believer in his imamat. He prayed for me about wealth and children, and today I have both. Reference: Kashful Ghamma, page 123, Damatus Sakiba, volume 3, page 125. An Indian magician came to the court of Mutawakkil and astonished the audience through his tricks. Mutawakkil thought it would be a good idea to degrade Imam Ali Naqi Hadi through him. So he summoned the Imam and made the magician sit beside the Imam, as he had requested. After some time, dinner was served. As soon as the Imam wanted to take up the loaf of bread, he made it fly away. Imam remained patient and the courtier started laughing, and the same thing was repeated. So much so that after three chances, Imam gestured to the line of the carpet and he became alive and devoured the magician. There was chaos in the court and Mutawakkil became senseless. He asked Imam to return the magician from the line of the carpet. Imam asked, had the staff of Musa returned the magicians? Saying this, he left the court. Reference: Shawahidun Nubuwa, page 209, Damatus Sakiba, volume 3, page 145. During Mutawakkil's rule, a woman claimed to be Zainab, the daughter of Ali and Fatima, and also claimed that because of prayer of Prophet, she regained her youth every 40 or 50 years. Mutawakkil asked the scholars to refute this claim, but no one succeeded. So Fatah ibn Khakan summoned ibn Reza. Imam Ali Naqi Hadi said, Almighty Allah has made flesh of descendants of Prophet unlawful on animals. Send her to your lion den, and the truth will become clear. The courtiers got an idea and told the king why they should not try this first with the Imam himself. And they sent the Imam into the cage first. Imam agreed to it, while Mutawakkil watched the scene from a high post. The wild beasts placed their heads at the Imam's feet and he stroked them for some time. When he came out, his miracle became famous everywhere. Mutawakkil presented expensive gifts to the Imam, and impostor Zainab was exposed. It also proved that those who falsely claim to be Sayyids are not worth more than this Zainab. Reference: Jilaul Uyun, page 293, Sawaikul Muhrika, page 124, Arjahul Matalib, page 461, Damatus Sakiba, volume 3, page 145. We should know that the law that Imam stated is only for the direct descendants of Holy Prophet through Lady Fatima. After that, all are called as descendants of Prophet generally. Yunus, the gemstone craftsman, lived in the neighborhood of the Imam, and once the ruler gave him an expensive jewel to work on. Perchance, when he was working on it, it broke. He came to the Imam and explained the matter, who assured him that it would be all right. Yunus was restless. At last, a messenger came summoning him to the court. Imam said, go, everything will be all right. When Yunus came to the court, the king asked him if he had finished polishing the stone. Yunus said the work was incomplete. The king said, there is dispute among my two sons, so cut it up into two for each of them. Yunus promised to do that and felt happy that what the Imam had assured proved true. Reference: Aam Ali, Sheikh Mufid, Biharul Anwar, volume 9, chapter 3, 133. In 234th year after Hijra, as soon as he came to the throne, Mutawakkil started a new mischief and tried to involve people in such a dispute that they always remain at throats of each other and do not pay any attention to the oppressions of the regime, which is the trick employed by all expert politicians. So he appointed Abu Bakr ibn Shaiba in Masjid-e-Rasafa and his brother Uthman in Masjid-e-Mansur as leaders of congregation and told them to popularize divine qualities, seeing God and creation of Quran, and make people involved in this contradiction. Then left Mu'tazila faith and declared acceptance of Shafi'i, and debates ensued between the two sects. After creating this mischief, he turned his attention to destruction of the relics of Ahlul Bayt, and first people were prevented to do ziyarat of Imam Hussein, and then the job of destroying the signs of the grave was entrusted to a neo-Muslim convert from Jewish faith. He tried all means to till the land, but animals refused to do job, as many animals have more recognition of the Imam than some so-called Muslims. The result of these operations of Mutawakkil was that many natural calamities occurred, and according to some books of history, even 10-ounce stones dropped from the sky. This happened in 237th year after Hijra. Reference: Tariq-e-Islam, volume 1, page 65. मुतवक्किल एट दैट टाइम वॉज ऑल्सो बिजी इन सेटिंग अप द टाउन ऑफ सामर्रा विच वॉज कॉल्ड एज ब्राइड ऑफ सिटीज एंड विच वॉज स्प्रेड अप टू 21 miles इन रेडियस ईच ऑफ इट्स ग्राउंड अकोमोडेटेड अप टू 90,000 सोल्जर्स. दिस कंटिन्यूड फॉर 10 years एंड ऑपरेशन ऑन आल मोहम्मद वॉज स्टॉप्ड फॉर सम टाइम एंड टिरनीज वर लिमिटेड टू इराक. वेन दिस वर्क वॉज अकम्प्लिश्ड मुतवक्किल टर्न्ड हिज अटेंशन टू मदीना एंड प्लान टू रेक हैवॉक देयर. Abdullah ibn Muhammad was appointed as governor in order to persecute the Sadat. Imam Ali Naqqi Hadi complained about the governor to Mutawakkil in order to keep him informed, and he, instead of deposing the governor, took it as a pretext of calling the Imam to Samarra and said, "Since you are facing problems in Medina, please move to Samarra." Thus he got a chance to oppress the Imam directly to keep him away from the people. Reference Jilaul Uyun, page 292. Nurul Absar, page 149. Instead of sending letter to summon Imam, Mutawakkil sent a battalion of 300 men, which was apparently to show that the son of messenger was being called with respect and honor. But the actual plan was to arrest the Imam, therefore the Imam had to leave his family as well as the tomb of the Prophet. But Providence made sure that Mutawakkil would not succeed in this plan as well. And according to Yahya ibn Harsama, there was a devotee of Ahlul Bayt also who was taunted all the way, and on reaching a well, people said, "Your master has said that up to 70 dead would be removed from each land. There is no inhabitation here. So how it could be possible?" He said, "Although I cannot prove it, but if my master has said thus, it cannot be wrong." After that, when the letter of Mutawakkil was handed to Imam in Medina, he asked for a day or two and began to make preparations for winter and rain. There was a furor in the army that what was the use of this preparation, and they again started making fun of that devotee of Ahlul Bayt. Finally, the caravan set out after 3 days. When they reached deep into the desert, at night a terrible storm struck and a heavy downpour started. People began to freeze with death. The Imam ordered his followers to put on winter clothes and as far as possible helped the army of Yahya also. By the morning, 80% lost their lives. They were buried at that same place under the instruction of Holy Imam. And the statement of Imam Ali proved true. And the enemies of Ahlul Bayt were debased, and the devotee of Ahlul Bayt was honored, and ever Yahya embraced the faith of Ahlul Bayt. Reference Kashful Ghumma, page 124. On reaching Samarra, he was lodged in the center of the poor Khanus Salik, so that people may not learn about his true personality. A person named Saleh ibn Sa'id met the Imam and expressed his regret that it was not a place worthy of lodging the Imam. It was an obvious injustice. Imam made a gesture and Saleh saw that the Garden of Paradise was visible there. Imam said, "Saleh, it is for this hereafter that we bear the hardships of life." Saleh became reassured at this. Reference Shawahidun Nubuwa, page 208, Nurul Absar, page 150. After some days, the Imam was taken out from there and placed under house arrest in a house where apparently sympathetic treatment was given, but actually he was kept in a spiritual and mental torture. Taking advantage of apparently kind behavior of the regime, the faithful began to frequent the house of the Imam and asked for solution of all problems. So much so that an applicant came to his door, but he was not at home, so he searched him till the village. Although he asked for 10,000, the Imam gave him a letter for 30,000 and said, "You ask me when I am surrounded by people." He did that, and the ruler sent the money to maintain a show of respect. The man said, "I am only indebted for 10,000. Imam said, "The remaining would also be useful to you." He came out from there repeating, "Allah knows best where to place his message." Reference Nurul Absar, page 150. Sawaikul Muhrika, page 123, Shawahidun Nubuwa, page 207, Arjahul Matalib, page 461. We should know that the aim of writing a request note was to highlight the fact that I am promising to pay so and so person such and such amount, even though I am not indebted to him. So in this way, the payment becomes a responsibility of the regime, like the Almighty Allah has promised to reward all the faithful and doers of good, and this had become his logical and legal responsibility, although he one owes nothing to anyone, and neither a creature has a right on the creator. When the Imam was placed under house arrest, people complained to Mutawakkil that the Imam's followers were holding weapons in his house and he was going to rise up against him shortly. Mutawakkil approved night raids and soldiers entered the house to find the Imam seated on his prayer mat engrossed in recitation of the Quran. They brought him to court and informed Mutawakkil that no weapons were found at his place. He offered the Imam a cup of wine and he said, "You know well that wine has not been absorbed into flesh and skin of Al Muhammad." He asked the Imam to recite some couplets and he said, "I rarely recite couplets," but when he insisted, he recited the following: "Those who had spent their lives in luxuries in lofty palaces are one day brought down from there and buried in a pit, which is going to serve as a grave. After their burial came the voice, 'Where is the throne and crown and the royal dress? And where are the soft and delicate faces before which expensive veils were hung?' The grave replied in displaying its condition that today worms are crawling on those faces. They continue to consume worldly wealth for a time and now worms are feeding on them. As a result of this, Mutawakkil fell down unconscious and when he regained senses, he dismissed the gathering of wine and bid farewell to the Imam with respect." Reference: Wafayatul Ayan, Volume 1, page 322. Nurul Absar, page 150, Damatus Sakiba, Volume 3, page 142. After that also the oppression continued till another search order was issued, and Saeed Hajib says, "I entered the house from the rear and found it pitch dark inside. Imam Ali Naqi Hadi was engrossed in recitation of the Quran. When he heard someone descending the steps, he said, 'Wait, let me get light.' I was too much ashamed, but when I searched the house, I only found a sword and a bag that Mutawakkil's mother had sent. I presented these items to Mutawakkil, who sent it back and became ashamed of himself. But even after that, he did not give up harassing the Imam. Now, instead of house arrest, he had the Imam housed in jail. Initially, he was lodged in the prison of Zarafa and then handed over to Razzaqi, which cut off public access to the Imam." Reference: Shawahidun Nubuwa, page 208. Jilaul Uyun, page 294, Kashful Ghumma, page 124, Damatus Saqiba, Volume 3, page 131. Mutawakkil continued to harass the Imam due to his nature as well as constant instigation of his men, even though his own condition was precarious and there were protests in the whole kingdom. His own son and his personal slave were against him and there was utter chaos outside. But Imam Ali Naqi Hadi never tried to take advantage of the circumstances. So much so that after Mutawakkil, the condition worsened so much that his sons were deprived of rulership. During the reign of Musta'in, Yahya ibn Umar ibn Husayn ibn Zayd Alawi rebelled in Kufa. Hasan Dayyul Haq seized Tabristan and Turkish slaves rebelled in the capital. Musta'in had to flee from Samarra to Baghdad, where he sought refuge inside the fort, and at last he was slain at the hands of Mu'taz Billah. Mu'taz now perceived dangers from his brothers and he had his brother Mu'ayyad killed. Muwaffiq was imprisoned in Basra. There was such chaos in the country that anyone could have taken advantage of the situation and occupied the throne for some days. But such was the foresight of Imam Ali Naqi Hadi and Islamicness of his style compelled him not to take any advantage of circumstances. He did not even take part in any rebellion and continued to observe from sidelines, so that no opportunity is lost of defense of Islam and propagation of laws. In this way, he continued to serve the religion of his respected grandfather and continued to observe the tyrannical style of the regime. Reference: The Sway Imam, page 16. Mutawakkil, due to his mischievous nature, used to invent new methods of harassment. Thus, when he could not get a new idea, in 247th year after Hijrah, he again decided to raise the tomb of Imam al-Husayn, and first restrictions were laid on ziyarat, and after that visitors were punished by cutting off their limbs. So much so that when this information became public, two persons who were mad in devotion to Ahlul Bayt came out to offer sacrifices. Zayd the Majnoon set out from Egypt and Buhlul Adana set out from Kufa. First they devised a joint plan and then set out for Karbala. When they reached there, they saw the directions of Al-Qama river has been turned towards tomb and the holy grave was being erased. But no success was forthcoming as the water used to stop when it reached the grave. These two persons moved forward and the official representative inquired about their identity and the purpose of their visit. They introduced themselves and said, "They have come for ziyarat of the grave of the son of messenger." He asked, "Do you not know the punishment that is fixed for it?" They said, "We know it very well and we have come prepared." He was bewildered and he fell down at their feet. After that, he went to Mutawakkil and informed him about the incident. He killed that man and hung his corpse from the crucifix. Then he had his body dragged through the streets so that others would gain lessons from it. When Zaid learned about this, he immediately went to Samarra and after burying his corpse, recited the Holy Quran at his grave as he had accorded respect to visitors of the tomb of Imam al-Husayn and had laid down his life for it. After some days, Zaid heard about a death and when he came out, he saw a huge crowd. He thought that perhaps Mutawakkil had died, but it was his maid servant who had passed away and it was the respect that she commanded. Zaid took a deep sigh and exclaimed, "God, this is the honor of Mutawakkil's slave girl." And the corpse of Imam Hussain lay unburied for 3 days, and now the signs of his grave are also being eradicated. Indeed, we belong to Allah and to Him we shall return. After that, he composed some couplets and sent them to Mutawakkil, who got him arrested and imprisoned. But at night he saw that someone was threatening to kill him, so he became worried and released Zaid, and he became engrossed in the mission of his service to religion. Reference: Biharul Anwar, Volume 2, Chapter 13, page 184. Mutawakkil had become so blatant in injustice that he neither had control over his tongue nor his limbs. So one day, in presence of his son Mustansir, he spoke insultingly about Lady Fatima. Mustansir asked the jurist what the Islamic verdict was about such persons. They said it makes one eligible to be executed. At night, Mustansir found Mutawakkil alone and killed him, and he died carrying the load of his sins. This occurred on 4th of Shawwal, 247th year after Hijrah. Reference: Tariq-e-Islam, Volume 1, page 66, Damat-us-Sakiba, Volume 1, page 147, Hadiyat-ut-Tawariq, etc. Please note that at some places in this chapter, there have been mistakes in printing where the name of Imam Muhammad Taqi is written instead of Imam Ali Al-Hadi.